evidence, there are some numbers that show as low as 5%, whereas others might say 50%. But if we be honest with ourselves, the thing that we really need to think about is that a lot of times when any of us are talking about abuse, there are some mental attachments to that. So in reality, the thing that we need to walk away from in all of this is that mental abuse is something that can be connected to any type of domestic violence. That's just the truth. There's something that can be lingering from what we navigate through, and it can be connected to our domestic violence relationship. One thing that I find to be so important is to make sure that we're honoring our truth. Quite often, we get into a space where we tell people, you know, this is just a piece of what I'm feeling, or I'm just going to share with you what I think you want to hear. And that's not always healthy for us. It's important that we honor who we are. That's a part of our own worthiness. We have to get connected to who we are at our core and understand that self-awareness leads to transformation. When you can become aware of who you are inside and everything that makes you who you are, including what you face, then you can step into a space where you can truly evolve and become the person you're called to be. So what does that mean? In one sense of the matter, it means that when you step in front of a mirror, you really have to look at yourself, not just at what you're seeing, but really look inside of yourself and understand, you know, who is this person? What does he, she feel like? There's some things that are inside of you that you have to be mindful of. So keep that in mind. Whenever you're talking to someone else, keep in mind just as well, you don't have to divulge everything that makes you who you are. You can share what you want to share, what your truth is, and what you feel comfortable in. So keep that in mind. And know that the truth that you hold to be true doesn't have to be approved, understood, accepted, or anything else by anyone else. It is your truth. So please don't ever step into a time where you say that I have to only share this, I have to only talk this way, or speak to these certain people by just sharing whatever they want to hear. It's not helpful to you or to them. And know that just as well, things are not always going to be so black and white. Things are going to be different for every person. Perception is different for everyone, so keep that in mind. Sometimes things are crystal clear for you, and that's good for you, and that's all that matters. Understand that you have to challenge previous definitions of yourself to evolve, to really become who you're called to be. Think about what you were facing in the past and know that you have to process through that to become something different, to really get through those difficult situations and make it. Holistic work. This is something that's very interesting, and I think that a lot of people don't really think about it. It can be kind of difficult, but what's important is that you understand you have to do the work yourself. As an individual, know that there are many things that make you who you are, mind, body, and spirit. There are things that are attached to your identity, your morals, your values, etc., that help you to be who you are. That could be connected to your social setting, that could be connected to your culture, the things that you're exposed to on a regular basis, etc. So know that whenever you're doing holistic work as you evolve yourself in your mental health, you have to pay attention to all of the little spaces that are in there and don't ignore them. If there's a piece of you that is still hurting, if there's a piece of you that's confused, if there's a piece of you that's even questioning your identity, be mindful of that and take care of all of those spaces. See, sometimes when we think about getting well, let's take, for example, physical health, you may take medicine. You may find time to meditate. You may find time to just take care of the things that you see physically happening to yourself. But when we think about doing real holistic work, doing that internal work is something entirely different. You have to think about yourself as a whole being. You're not just what people see on the outside. You are a person that's multifaceted, and you have to be mindful of that at all times. You can't ignore one piece or sacrifice one piece to make sure that the other is whole. That won't work. One thing that is very, very important here is when we talk about spirituality or religion or anything that's related to our true identity at our core, understand that you can be a prayerful person I'm a prayerful person. I believe fully in God, and I will say that to anyone at any time. That's who I am. But at the same time, I understand that faith is not something that just comes and it goes. It's not just something that you say, you know, I'm going to pray about this and I'm just going to wait for something to happen. That's not how that works. Prayer, our faith, our things that we're truly connected to, they require effort. They require you putting in the work, but still being connected to that. There's this kind of a melting pot, this mixing space that has to come together to ensure that faith and works are present. God told us to have faith, but he also gave us free will. Your free will can be you putting in the work and making sure that you're doing what you can to get into a better space in your mental health. When we talk about healthcare management, this is another space that's seriously important. A lot of times people will say, I'm going to tell you how to do this, and here's the list of things that you need to complete. And that's fine. But at the same time, we have to understand, both as survivors, as advocates, as thrivers, whatever you're calling yourself at present, that every person's situation is very different. So when we're feeding ourselves these different methods of evolution, or we're helping others to do the same thing, understand that it has to be individualized. You have to remember that some people don't have access to things like technology. Some people don't have access to high quality care. You just have to pay attention and really think about ways that you can help someone or help yourself to get the tools and the things that you need to succeed in a timely and effective manner. That's seriously important. When it comes to making sure that you have an effective support team, having someone that is a good quality coach is important. Having someone that is ICF compliant or certified is very important, because there are some things that they know how to do, some things that they know how to deliver that can help you to best evolve. And in that just as well, that person that is to support you, whether advocate, a coach, a therapist, whatever the case may be, it's very important that you understand that they're in alignment with you. Maybe you want somebody that looks like you, and that's fine. There are some things that people may not understand in your cultural space, and you want someone that's there that can understand you. That's totally fine. But also understand that experiences, what a person has endured, overcome, how they see life, all those things play a major role here. So keep that in mind when you're trying to find someone that can support you as you evolve your mental health and your life in general. Support systems are crucial, no matter what they're looking like. If it's a church group, if it's a circle of your best friends, that's fine. But know that you need people that are in your space that are all about your well-being, that truly care about who you are as a person, as an individual. Because if you don't have that, you're going to find some time when things seem really difficult, very confusing, and you may even have extreme doubts because you don't have some key support that you may need in your circle. Change is coming. Understand that you will continue to evolve as a person. And you have to know, I put on here TTM, and that's the trans-theoretical model of change. You have to understand that there are spaces and time where you know that you're ready to change, but there are also times when you say, well, I don't know, I'm not sure, I don't know how to do this. And that's okay, but you need to honor where you are and be able to evolve throughout that entire process. Whether we're talking about an advocate or survivor, having solution-focused processes is crucial. We can't get into this space where we're feeling like you just always want someone to hold you close and maybe hold your hand or maybe spoon feed you. I'm saying that lightly here, but you need to know that you need to have some goals in place. You need to have some things that you can focus on so that you can truly make this difference and really stay on track. Think about the environment that you're in. Things that are contributing to everything around you are seriously crucial. Keep that in mind. Strategically affect addressing of self-efficacy and self-regulation. You have to put in the work over and over again and be conscious of that and mindful of that. When you're talking about evolving who you are, you can't just think right inside of your little box. You have to think outside of that space to really find things that are going to help. We all need help. I don't care what stage of the survivor afterlife you may be in, we all need help, and that's fine. You're worthy of transformation, so make sure you're investing in yourself and level up today and every day of your life. You deserve it. All this is about worthiness. And last but not least, this is a way you can contact me. You can visit me at my website, drkaylanallen.com. I am a Well Coaches trained and ICF compliant coach, and I'm here ready to help people evolve and become who they're called to be. I have various audiences that I contribute to and different clientele. So please find me on social media under Dr. Kayla and Allen. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Kayla. That was amazing. I appreciate all of your help. And thank you for being here and giving us such amazing, information about transformation and mental health and being able to keep ourselves well aware about our mental health and also being aware of how to keep ourselves. And thank you for your information. Make sure to type that in also in Facebook and for people to also get in contact with you. I appreciate that. We are going to go ahead and keep going to our next person, which is Evangelist Patricia Fowler, which will be talking about sexual assault. I thank you, Evangelist, for being here. Like always, you talk about some amazing work, and I appreciate you being here. If you can share your slides with us about sexual assault, I'm just going to let you go.
So you're not sharing mine?
Of course I am.
Oh, okay.
I'll be the one doing that.
Don't scare me. Don't scare me like that.
I'm the one doing it. Just want to let people know.
Thank you, Cynthia. Well, good afternoon, everyone. I hope you can hear me. I am Evangelist Patricia Fowler. I am a survivor of domestic violence. My business is Pure Heart Advocacy and Counseling, LLC. I am also the COO of the Virginia Domestic Violence Rally. I'm a four-time author, and I'm the co-chair of the Domestic Violence Committee for the LM Foundation. So today I will be speaking about sexual assault. Okay, understanding your worth about sexual assault. What is sexual assault? Some people may know and some may not. So sexual assault is an act in which a person intentionally sexually touches another person without that person's consent or coerces or physically forces a person to engage in a sexual act against their will. It is a form of sexual violence, which includes children, elderly, women, and men. It involves groping, rape, forced vaginal penetration, a drug-facilitated sexual assault, or the torture of a person in a sexual manner. Nearly one in five women, 18.3%, and one in 71 men, 1.4%, reported experiencing rape at some point in their lives. That's a lot. That is a lot. One in 20 women and men experience sexual violence other than rape, such as being made to penetrate someone else. You have people that make others do certain things to people that they should not be doing. You know, they're standing by watching and instructing them on what to do. What are some of the effects of sexual assault? You have unwanted pregnancy. And a lot of people, you know, when they are sexually assaulted and get pregnant, they don't want to keep a baby from their assailant. You know, some of them get rid of the baby, get an abortion, but then some don't. They want to keep their baby, you know, but then they often live with the trauma of having a baby that was birthed out of something that was so evil. Of course, we know babies are blessings, but at times when it happens that way, it takes a toll on the person. You have sexual dysfunction. If a person is sexually assaulted at an early age, they may be scared to have sex when they get up age and get in a relationship. They may think that sex is a bad thing and have only bad ideas of it and not know that it can be something loving and something that is, you know, if you're married, it's something that's done in a marriage, you know? It can lead to infertility if they are brutally assaulted, which that has happened to quite a few women. It can lead to STDs, including HIV and AIDS, from persons that are on drugs or have used drugs and then assault someone sexually. It can lead to pelvic pain and UTIs. UTIs are urinary tract infection. If the person is a virgin, perhaps, it can damage them on the inside, maybe prohibiting them from having children or getting pregnant in the future. Some are so damaged from it, they lead to suicide because they blame themselves. They no longer want to live, and they think it's their fault that this happened to them. But in knowing your worth, you have to understand that if anything like this ever happens to you or anyone you know, it is not their fault. It is their fault, the fault of the abuser. It's never the victim's fault. It can also lead to depression. People get really depressed. Some people who are sexually assaulted do not tell anyone. It may be a person that was sexually assaulted when they're 5 years old. They may not tell anyone till they're an adult, till they're in their 20s or 30s even, for the fear of just being depressed about how sad this is and blaming themselves. They isolate themselves. They don't want to talk about it. They figure if they just don't tell anybody, it will just go away. Next slide. Okay, the top three reasons survivors don't report their sexual assaults. One is they don't want to report it because some will tell them, oh, it's not that serious, or say, I don't believe you. That's something you should never say to anyone, whether it's sexual assault, domestic violence, human trafficking, sexual, whatever it could be, you still don't want to tell that person you don't believe them. The second reason is others might think it's partly your fault or blame you. Again, as I said before, it is never your fault if you are sexually assaulted, sexually abused, domestic violence, human trafficked, or any of those things. It is never your fault. Never your fault. The third reason is fear of retaliation. You are not alone in this. And you have to know that, yes, you may be scared to tell. That's okay. It happens. You are not alone in feeling like that. That's a normal feeling and reaction to have when something bad has happened to you. But you have to know, and again, in understanding your worth, that it is better to share it with someone. Share it with someone. Maybe you may not want to go straight to the police right off, but maybe you can tell your best friend. Maybe you can tell your neighbor, and then maybe they will share it with someone that in turn, it will get you help for what you're going through, and then it will come out in the open. But don't ever fear retaliation, even though somebody may say, you know, if you tell anybody, I'm going to kill you, I'm going to kill your family. And I know that threat can be taken, you know, real. You know, you don't want to think somebody's playing when they say that. But at the same time, you have to know that if you don't say anything, they still could harm you. So it's best to tell somebody kind of regardless of what you're going through, because you could suffer for years of damage if you never said anything to anybody. 90% of women who are sexually assaulted in college know they're attacker. It's more likely someone they've been hanging out with, somebody they have a class with, somebody that they know really well. You know, sometimes females have male friends that they say, oh, he's like a brother to me. And they get so close to you that they may end up hurting you and you can't believe they did this, but then you don't want to tell because you feel like, well, he's a brother to me. I don't want to get him in trouble. I don't want to send him to jail or anything like that. But in the meantime, you're suffering in silence. You're suffering from the hurt you feel because this person that you thought was so close to you have now damaged you and has hurt you. Don't suffer. Don't suffer. 1 in 33 men are victims of attempted or completed rape. Now, we don't hear men talk about what they go through a lot, but they go through it. 1 in 33 men. 1 in 33. 60% of college assaults occur in the residence hall, and that's where they live at, in the dorm room, late at night. They come in after a frat party. It's 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. They've been drinking, smoking, whatever. although that's not an excuse nor a reason, but that's usually when it happens. 1 in 5 women experience some form of sexual assault in college. Rarely do we hear about it often, but it's happening. So we have to be aware. You have to know your worth. Be aware of your surroundings, who you're hanging with, what's going on, and if something should happen to you, please confide in someone. So you have to learn the facts about sexual violence. Use your voice to prevent it. Knowing your worth is valuable than keeping silent. Open your mouth and tell someone. Share your story with someone. And that's going to bring mine to a close. I have some resources listed here below. In Prince William County, we have Acts in Service. Their number is there. In Fairfax, Virginia, we have Domestic Violence and Sexual Assault Hotline. In Alexandria, Virginia, we have Sexual Assault and Domestic Violence Hotline also. And in Arlington, Virginia. And on my last page is my contact information if you want to reach out to me for a workshop or to purchase one of my books. My information is here for you. My email, my phone number, and all my social media handles are listed, as well as my telephone number. You can reach me on there. So thank you. That will conclude my session on sexual assaults.
Thank you so much, Evangelist. You are always a pleasure. I always love watching all of your your seminars. They're amazing. And
thank
your
you.
Information. I'm going to let you introduce our next guest.
Which is? Next we will have Ms. Tanice coming in to speak about domestic violence and bullying. And we will welcome Tanice to the panel.
I'm sorry, guys.
It's Ms. Jolene. It's Ms.
Jolene.
Sorry, Ms. Jolene.
Hello, everybody.
How are you, Ms. Jolene?
I am excited.
I think you're mute. I think you're muted.
You know, with this technology, and I'm in the back and I'm listening and it's all exciting. Are you able to hear me now?
Yes. Yes, we are.
Able to see me now?
Yes, ma'am, we are.
Okay.
I'm going to share your domestic violence slides. That way everyone will get an opportunity to see your slides, and then we'll go ahead and start your slides.
Okay.
Here we go.
Okay. First of all, I'd like to say thank you so much, Cynthia, for giving me this opportunity to be a part of this important symposium. My name is Jolene. I am a survivor and an advocate. To have an opportunity to talk as I go through my slides, I will be intertwining a lot of my own personal experience. As a young military wife, I was subjected to emotional abuse. And that one, I think, kind of, it's an inside trauma, but as we go forward, we will look at what it encompasses and what happens, what is the whole process that we're looking at around domestic violence. Number one, what is it? Knowing the signs. I think that is so important. So let's look at what is domestic violence? Next slide, please. One of the things that I use here in California, if I was actually doing this face-to-face, I would have this booklet. And I'm so happy that Evangelist talked earlier about having resources. Reaching Out is a book that was put together in Los Angeles County. I'm coming from the West Coast, and I'll have my information at the end. But this is what I want everybody to have in their hands. Since we're virtual, we're going to make sure that you get the information anyway, and that we're going to always have resources. I always believe with education, we should come resources. So shout out to LA County for putting this together. I have the information that if you want a copy, you definitely can get a copy, and it is free. Majority of the information that I will be sharing is coming out of this little pamphlet, small but mighty, called Reaching Out. Next slide, please. Okay, what I would like to talk about is, first of all, what is domestic violence? People use violence and abuse in domestic violence relationships. The one takeaway is power and control. The gain power and control over the victim. And it is in an intimate fashion because you're in a relationship. So consequently, it's a cycle, it's a pattern. And that's one of the things that I will talk about to make sure that everyone understands, and we hear this a lot, why do they stay? I hope by the end of my presentation, by the end of the symposium, you will be able to see this is a complex, very psychological base, control and power in different ways. You've heard some ways that you can be controlled. One of the ones that I'm going to just touch on, I wish I could do it all, but we're in a time constraint. One of the ones that I found that was very shocking as I went through my presentation, economic. And I've known firsthand how economic looks like. You wouldn't think that a person would come for your credit score. You wouldn't think that someone would try to deliberately sabotage you at work. But once again, we're talking about power and control. So if I can get you to lose your job, or if I can get you to mess up your credit score, how likely is it that you're going to be able to go and get an apartment? Another one we hear a lot about, and that is threats. And I'm going to talk about the harassment piece. You wouldn't think about it, but a lot of times it's saying things over and over in your mind. This is what you are. This is what embarrassing you in public. Saying things to your family. Anything that can be unwanted contact with your partners, with your family. Anything that's going to make you look bad. Once again, we're talking about the power and control. Next slide, please. Continuing on types of abuse. Now, this is one, once again, looking at these, destruction of property. You would think to yourself, why would my mate want to come out and flatten my tires? You know, it's your car too. Well, we're talking about power and control again. If I know that you got an important meeting to be at in the morning, and I feel like I'm going to help some, this is about power and control. So it could look like destruction of property. And oftentimes these things are minimized, especially as I look through it, kicking, holds. You know, sometimes you'll say, oh, I just lost my temper and I punched the hole in the wall. Okay, that's destruction. And we already had such an excellent evangelist went over the sexual violence piece. And I'm just going to skip straight on into what most people think, and I did too, in addition to being a victim advocate, and I'm a social worker. A lot of times you think that it's all about physical abuse. I'm ashamed to tell you how long I thought that DV was just simply somebody's hitting you, kicking you, you got a bruise. But unfortunately, it is more in depth. When we look at this chart, destruction of property, sexual violence, physical abuse, isolation, verbal abuse. This can be happening all in conjunction. It could be happening all at one time. Imagine having to negotiate through all of these different things. And what I want to emphasize, these are signs that should be noted in the beginning of the relationship. And I'm talking about myself. Oftentimes we do see these signs, but we have our rose-colored glasses. We all want to be loved. So this, if I can't emphasize any other takeaway, the takeaway is look at these signs as you enter into this relationship, especially if you started out and you guys were outgoing and doing things with other people. Now, all of a sudden, the individual does not want you to go anywhere. That is really, really a sign to be looking at. Verbal, that was mine. I was told that I was crazy. How many times can you hear that in a 10-year relationship, a 10-year marriage? You're crazy. If something happens to I'm going to take the kids away from you. It took me years to get that out of my brain, out of my mind. It took education and prayer and what we're doing now. So I wouldn't continuously think, oh, am I crazy? And underneath this sign, one that I love, gaslighting, making a partner question their own sanity. These are serious signs. They show up subtly, but if you look at it the way it's set up here all together, these are definite signs to pay attention to. And if you're in a clinicians, I know we're talking to clinicians, I'm talking to social workers. These are things that once you're interviewing a client, or maybe the client's just talking to you about, these are things that you can know that will help you help them stay safe and come up with an intervention plan. So thank you so much. Next slide, please. This one is probably the most integral. And I'm not going to spend too much time because you can always contact me and get copies of this. But I just want to let you know how it looks, what it looks like. Remember, we said it's power and control. We also said it was cyclical. It goes around and around. I think this chart right here just lays it out. It's the honeymoon period, okay? That's when everything is going good. You know, the abusers, promises. You probably gotten some roses. Everything is, you guys might be having your favorite dinner. You even might be taken out to your favorite restaurant. Oh, wow. Your hope is back. You're in your honeymoon period. But there's some tension underneath that. And that tension building phase is the next one. That's when the abused partner feels growing tension and stress. You try to control it. And the best way, I love this little powerful chart here, because you do feel like you're walking on eggs. Although you just came out this honeymoon period, you're already kind of thinking to yourself, I might forget to put the dinner on the table at a certain time. I might want to go over to see my mom. You're going to be constantly getting that walking on the eggs feeling with this individual. Still ain't feeling all that comfortable. Then you're going into explosion. And one thing I loved is I was reading this, because this is a good thing about when we're educating ourselves again. The explosion period, in some type of way, it gets out of control. Maybe this is where we see and we think in our brain, oh, this is when you do physically see somebody with a black eye, with a broken arm. But this person has been going through these phases before you actually see the manifestation of what happened. And what I want to emphasize on this, in this phase, initially it's the shortest stage, but increases in length over time. That's where the deadly part comes in. It's going to be short this time, but as this person stays into the relationship, this is going to grow. And then once again, we're going to go back to maybe it's going to work out this time. Love, hope, and fear. If the takeaway that I want everyone is that this is why you cannot casually say to anyone, why do they stay? This is more of an important reason, because they got hope. They're in love. They have children. There's an investment. Who would not want to make it work? This is why I'm so thankful to be part of this symposium, so I can talk from a personal point of view that it is very deadly, and it's also, it sneaks up on you. You don't really know it. I didn't even know it until I started working on my education. I wasn't aware. Oftentimes it's intergenerational. You maybe grew up seeing your mom not having money to buy stuff. You might have grew up having your mom called names. So when you get in a relationship, you might have normalized it. So this is the slide of the slide. I mean, it has helped me. It helped me put this presentation together, because it let me know why we need to do more and more and more of these type of educational symposiums. Thank you so much. Next slide, please. This one is the one, as we say, this is the money slide. It could happen to anyone. And the stigma that comes with it is always pictured as someone who is low income, who has a lot of other stressors. I love the fact that we are talking about, we are all in this together. I said that earlier, I'm gonna say it again. We're all in this together. And it doesn't look, it's, you could be the same sex, same gender. You could be educated. You could be living behind a gated community. Violence happens in all communities and can happen to anyone regardless of your gender, your identity, your race, your age, income, or appearance. It happens to anyone. So once again, a takeaway is every person experiencing DV deserves help and support. Don't ignore these signs of emotional abuse. When you see these signs, and I'm so happy that you're not just going to get education, you're going to get resources, because we know it could happen to anyone. Don't beat yourself up about it. Don't say, I got a PhD and I'm going home and I'm getting beat up. It has nothing to do with that. We're all in this together. Thank you. Next slide, please. This is where I really like to look at, and I'm shocked every time I look at it. When we look at the numbers speak for themselves. It could happen to anyone, and we're looking at the fact that 1 in 4 women and 1 in 10 men are impacted. If I was doing this in person, I would do a count off. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. That means in that room, someone has experienced it, went through it, is going through it. Also, I want to emphasize that it also occurs among same sex. I was a novice. I really don't get taught a lot about it. When I went to school back in the 90s, it wasn't talked about. But I'm so happy that I became an advocate, because as an advocate, I got to learn that this is also a very deadly and not many resources is for our brothers and sisters that are in these transgender relationships, that are in same-sex relationships. It occurs among them too. 54% transgender has experienced, 26% gay, and 44% lesbian. Should I say this again? Yes, I'm gonna say it again. We are all in this together. Thank you so much. Next slide, please. Now I get to talk about my favorite book, and this is the one that we're using. I thank LA County Board of Supervisors. I'm on the West Coast, as I stated, but this book is free. If I could get it to you, if you would like to know any more about it. And I'm sure that in each one of your communities, there's something like this. It's compact. It's something that you can present. You can mail it. You can have it at your churches as something that you can use. I have the number if you can see it. I apologize. It's not so good on that slide. But there is the commission that put this together, and it's called the Los Angeles County Commission for Women. Public and private agencies put this together. And one of the things that I want to emphasize is that we have partners. We have partners of agencies that we've already went to. So when someone comes to us and they need help, we won't just send them on what I used to call a wild goose chase. Back in the day, if you had a domestic problem situation going on, you were just told, well, get a restraining order. You wasn't given something tangible. And what I believe in and what we're talking about today, we want to let the takeaway, you know how to get some help. You're not going to be left. We're in this together once again. So I have to shout out to LA County. This book is free. And if you need a copy of it, have my information at the end. The slides are shareable. You definitely will be able to get this copy. I can't say enough about this book. Thank you. Next slide, please. Domestic Violence Safety Plan. Once again, as an advocate, I became involved with an organization here in Long Beach. It's called In Abuse Long Beach. When I got my copy, my hands on this Domestic Violence Safety Plan, this is something that as a social worker, an advocate, and also I have my own nonprofit, this is always on my desk. It's also available. It comes in Spanish as well as English. What I love about it is it gives you your plan. Of course, for the lack of time, I can't go into the whole plan, but what you'll see that I think is so important is safety during an explosive incident. Remember, I already talked about it. It's going to happen. It's not maybe, it's going to happen. So what I love about this, it tells you what to do. For example, let's look at the first one. If an argument seems unavoidable, have it in a room or area that has access to an exit, not in the bathroom, kitchen, or anywhere near weapons. This is something that you wouldn't think of because you're panicking. But see, we're preparing whomever that might come in contact with these situations, which is 1 in 4, we found out with women. Most of us know somebody who have had to deal with this. But when you got a plan, as we used to say, when you have a plan, work the plan. This plan right here is encompassing everything that you need to stay safe and get help. The second thing I love about it is have a secret code. So Evangela Fowler, I might call you up and say, you know what? I forgot the ice cream. Well, you know that I ain't talked to you about nothing about no ice cream. So you already know that I'm sending you a signal. So once again, this is so important. Let someone know that you trust. You're not alone. You're going to hear me say it because that's the theme for my presentation. You're not alone. And we're going to make sure that when we're not all together, you're still not going to be alone. Because as you see, I have resources. Evangelist Fowler has resources. Everyone is coming behind me. We have resources. But I really like this because it prepares you. Next slide, please. The Long Beach Domestic Violence Referrals. Every area will have this. Every area will have their referrals. So we've had, with In Abuse Long Beach, we have already had relationships with these organizations. I have worked with situations where I've had a victim in front of me, and we calling around and they're saying that they can't take. It is so important as clinicians, providers, whatever role that you have a relationship with these organizations in your community that you've already interviewed, you've already went to, you already talked to them, you already said, what is the criteria? What happens if I get someone in the middle of the night? How is that? That is homework. They've already done this in this little brochure, but I'm going to just talk about something that's not on the flyer that we all should do. We all should do this. We all should have our bank books together. We all should have social security cards of the children together. We all should have our birth certificate somewhere in a safe place. We all should have copies of our driver's license. One important thing, everyone that I didn't think about, have that phone charger. If you got to get 2 phone chargers, 1 in the car, 1 in the suitcase, you know, 1 over at your girlfriend's house, make sure that you have that charger, because we don't think about that. I'm running for my life. I'm not thinking about grabbing a charger, but if I'm putting together a safety plan, in that safety plan, I'm going to have these numbers as well as my important documents, because there's nowhere you go more than know. This COVID-19 pandemic has let me see how important it is to have your paperwork, because that's the first thing they're going to want to know is who are you? And you might leave the house and have none of this. So I just want to emphasize, work the plan, and we're going to give you a plan. Thank you so much. May I have the next slide, please? This is the most important thing that I've done since I entered into this my new decade. In addition to giving birth to my two children, the most important thing that I've gave birth to is this book. This is my first novel. It's called Conversations with Mom. As I was putting this together, I thought about the times that my mother suffered emotional abuse. See, I didn't know about it. Once again, I said it was normalized. Financial abuse as well. It's not anything like cutting off your money supply. It could be something as I need to go buy personal items. So this book is my first novel. I'm going to have to put my information in the chat line because I didn't get a chance to add it. But it is on my website. I am available to do what my goal is to do a workshop because we all have moms, regardless of how it looked like. I work with foster youth. I wanted this book for everybody. My foster youth felt abandoned. But once again, I wanted to have conversations with mom as an opportunity for us to have conversations with mom, whether she's here or not. Mama has been gone for a long time. But let me, this book healed me, and I do believe it's going to heal others. As I put this slide together, I realized how this book tied into what we're talking about, the isolation, the shame, the fear. I got a chance to really conceptualize this as I was sharing my walk with my mom, things I told her, things I wished I could, things I could have discussed. So that is my wrap up. I am available to speak, to talk to any groups. Zoom is my new house. Although I'm on the West Coast, I'm usually up on your time. So do not hesitate to reach out to me as I put my information in the chat box. I thank you for this opportunity. And if you can't get in touch with me, I know you know how to get in touch with Cynthia, and she will definitely get back. But really quick, my website is www.JerlineRideau.com. If you go to that website, you'll get an opportunity to look at what we do at New Impression, because I am a CEO of a nonprofit. And I'm just honored. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. And I'm available for any other groups out there, because I think the more we talk about this education and the more we educate one another, this has been an education for me as well. And I will use a lot of the stuff that I'm learning from each one of the presenters to help families out here on the West Coast. So thank you so much.
Thank you, Ms. Jolene, for being here. I appreciate it. Evangelist, I'll leave it up to you. Thanks so much.
And next, we will have Ms. Tanise Freeman speaking on domestic violence and bullying. Welcome, Ms. Tanise. Hi, hello.
How are you?
Good, good.
Miss Denise, if you want us to share the screen with you, or do you want me to do the slideshow for you?
Can you do it for me, please?
Yes, I can definitely do that. Okay, there you go.
All right. Okay. So I'm mostly talking about bullying within like school, family, and relationships. So starting with your family, I have that, you know, you have people in your family that you thought may have loved you, but they talk about you behind your back, and then they start ignoring you and doing other things to you in person. So that is, to me, it's more of an emotional thing, because you get emotionally detached from your family. So there could be a many different things you could do in there that your family has put you through. They make you think like there's nothing that you've done to do anything to them. And that also trickles down to when you get to school. So now you're at school and you have other students talking about you behind your back. It could be because of your weight or the certain things that you're wearing. They think you're not wearing the stylish clothes that, you know, kids think that you're supposed to wear. It could be because of your size. You're too small, or you're heavier than certain people. So it could be a number of things that could be driven to bully you in school. Maybe you're too smart for them. Now you have them doing all types of things to you at school. They're either throwing stuff at you, trying to knock you down, picking at you, hitting you, and all types of other stuff. This is more of a emotional and physical bullying. In my personal experiences, I've had people doing all those things to me. I had a girl when I was in school picking on me because I was a smaller girl and she was a bit heavier. So she threw all my stuff on the floor, talked about me behind my back to everybody in my classes. As you're getting older, bullying can trickle down to work. It trickles down to someone at work picking at you, asking you to do stuff for them, asking you to do projects with them and things like that. And then it turns into you just doing it all by yourself, and then them taking credit for nothing. They've done no work and said that, you know, oh, I helped, and they never did anything. I've also had people do that. I work in the medical field where people say, can you help me? And then they walk off and expect you to do it all by yourself. So you have patients that need a lot of work, and they don't want to do the work because somebody's extra needy in the hospitals and stuff. So there is more things that people have always found ways to get through it. So coming into domestic violence, for me personally, it was my insecurities. We all have insecurities about things that start off with bullying. So with school, for me, it was just my size. I didn't always feel like I was small enough or that I was big enough for the people in my classes. So I know we all have insecurities. It's not about one thing, it's about another. Mine was my body. I didn't like the way I looked in the mirror. I thought my breasts were too small and my butt was just as small. I was not what I thought men would want as I got older. So I wanted to have bigger breasts. I thought men wanted women with larger breasts. So I always thought I should have bigger breasts. So I started trying to buy relationships. I always wanted to invite people places, and I'd offer to pay. There was more things that I thought I should be helping to pay for just to have friends around. I thought that was what was going to make me happy. Then it comes to things about my family. I wanted to have a family for my kids, and I wanted a family with a mother and a father in the house. So because I had my own daddy issues, I put myself and my kids through more than they needed to go through just to have a mother and father in the house. But I didn't know my own self-worth at that time because of my daddy issues. I didn't have a father to run to or to talk to about anything. So it showed me how I wasn't supposed to be treated, not having my father around, or how to even handle the things that men would say or do in relationships. So my story is more of my sons and daughters. My sons and daughters' fathers were both physically, verbally, financially, and emotionally abusive to me. I was accused of cheating on a daily basis from the both of them. I was stalked for months from at least one of them. My daughter's father moved around the corner from me, and he would pay people to play on my phone, ride past my house on a regular basis. And it became just, it was horrible for me. It was a horrible experience. When I wouldn't answer phone calls, he would come around the corner and bang on the doors. This one time, my cell phone was out of service, and he had been calling the house phone. So this one day, me and my kids were going to do something at work for my job. We were doing community service. And because I wasn't answering the phone, he decided to come around the corner. Well, he caught us coming out of the house and going into my car into the garage. He blocked us in the garage for about 10 minutes, banging on the windows, yelling through the windows. And eventually he decided to get back in his car and back out. He finally backed out, and I backed out behind him, and then he chased me down the street. I had a very small car, and he had a very large truck. So I was scared for more of my kids' lives before mine, because they were in the back seat, and they were about 3 and 4. He chased us for about 5 minutes down the street. I had no way to call my mother, 911, because I didn't have a cell phone at that time. So I was on my way to my mother. So once I got to her, she was ready to jump in and take action as a mom to help. But I never called the police to make a police report, which is one of my own insecurities. Like, oh, it's just, you know, we'll fix it. But it's just not, don't ever think that a man is supposed to do that to you. It's never right to be stalked or to be chased or abused in any type of way. Getting down to getting out, what I had to do for myself was figure out who I am. Figuring out who I am was not an easy task. It was so not easy. Now I had to figure out how to get better. I went to support groups for being in domestic violence relationships. I found God. But my biggest moment was getting it together. One day I was watching a video with Gabrielle Union, and she was talking about her counseling sessions and what she had to do. Well, her counselor asked her, who was she? And she couldn't answer it. And when I thought about it, neither could I. I couldn't answer who I was to myself. All I could say was, I'm a mom. I had no other things to say good about myself, what I wanted to do, where I was going, or what my kids would be able to say about me. So I had to find out what I wanted to do to make my life better and to make me happy for me and my kids. But for the most part, I needed to find out what would make me happy within myself and be able to look at myself in the mirror and say, I've done it. I am a beautiful person and all the good things about me. So to make sure you find out who you are before you get to know someone else, I listen to many different things, teachings, and other people looking at myself. I looked at my past and how I wanted to live in the future. So that's pretty much my little story in a nutshell. But I did go through domestic violence with many of my relationships because I didn't know who I was. So I've been through all different forms. I've been mostly financial, but with my kids' fathers, it was also very, very physical. Where I needed to either call the police or I've had to go to urgent care or to the hospital. So it's not a good thing for anything or to let anyone get you down like that. So, I'm done.
Thank you so much, Tanise, for being here. We love your story. And we know that you are no longer a victim, but you know what, you are a survivor. And thank you so much for being a survivor and for helping other survivors go through their struggle. Thank you again for your story.
Thank you. You're welcome. I also put up, I have my own online boutique, and I put a code up there for a discount for anyone.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, next on our schedule, it's me. I guess I'm next on the schedule. So I will be sharing the screen with everyone so that you guys can get a look of what I will be sharing with everyone. That way you guys will get an opportunity to see what I will be... Oops. Let's start from the beginning. There we go. And start up here. So I'll be talking about teen dating violence, and because it is TDV, and TDV is, as we know, teen dating violence is February month, awareness month, and I'm very big about teen dating violence. I'm huge about being able to educate people about teen dating violence awareness. Usually teach it at the schools to teenagers, and usually give them awareness about teen dating violence, just because we need to start at the age. And, you know, teen dating violence, and let's just go into what it really means. And I'm going to hide the floating controls because I can't really see. There we go. So what is TDV? What is teen dating violence? It includes physical, psychological, or sexual abuse, harassment, or stalking of any persons aged 12 to 18, and the contents of past or present romantic or consensual relationships. Now, a lot of times a lot of people think, well, you know, my teenager is dating an 18-year-old. They're almost to the point where they're 17, they're 15, and an 18-year-old. Really, if they're in between that line where they're 17 and the guy's almost turned 18, they're still between that romantic stage. They're still consensual. It doesn't matter. If the teenager just turned 18, they're still consensual. It does not matter. And you cannot call the police and say, well, they're the guy is 18. It doesn't matter. If he falls within that time limit, it's still consensual. But here's the line, guys. If he is abusing your daughter or your son, it's still considered teen dating violence. It's still considered TDV. It doesn't matter. Now, if the teenager is 18 years old, you're more than welcome to go ahead and stipulate those laws that you can go to because he's 18. You're more than welcome to. And there's a deputy that's going to come on here, so you can ask any questions you want on Facebook but she's going to be talking about sex trafficking. It's still falling under the line where you can get a no trespassing ordinance or a protective order against that 18-year-old. Now, between the ages of 12 to 17, there is no trespassing ordinance. There's no protective order. Not yet. We're still fighting on that. Now, who does this affect? Nearly 1.5 million teenagers are in a romantic relationship, and they all admit to an unhealthy relationship. Almost 1.5 million. Now, nearly 25% of teenage girls are estimated to have been in an abusive relationship. Now, mind you, right now, we are in a virtual world. But even in a virtual world, these kids are still in a very unhealthy, unabusive relationship with their consensual significant other. Girls between 16 to 24-year-olds, that means they're in college, guys, three times or more likely than to be in that are other demographics to be abused by a boyfriend or intimate partner, meaning they could be living together. And this doesn't matter. The victims in a teen dating violence are equal opportunity. Regardless of gender, regardless of socioeconomical status, regardless of sexual orientation, regardless of race, it doesn't really matter. We do not care about gender, race, socioeconomic. It doesn't matter. Teen dating violence, it's totally transparent. It's just like domestic violence. And it happens to just about everybody. Now, certain types of abuse of situations, it happens just like it does with intimate partner violence. Teen dating violence is exactly the same. There's stalking, there's physical violence, there's harassments, there's psychological and emotional abuse, there's sexual violence and assault, there's isolation. It happens exactly the same. But the situations between teen dating violence and how it's different is that with teen dating violence is that they use more issues of, you know, cyber more than they do physical, but they do more cyber issuing than they do more harassment. You could see more higher issues of harassment, more stalking, more psychological, more emotional. That's more of the issues that you see here. Now, mind you, there is a lot more sexual. Yes, there's isolation. They do a lot more stalking. They do a lot more harassment. You see that they will isolate a person like they used to be in a clique, and now they're not in the same clique. So you see that all of the time. Let me get back here. Okay. So what are some statistics that you see? About 80% of girls who have been physically abused in their relationships continue dating their abuser. And you see that all the time. They get sexually assaulted. Like you see, Evangelist said the same thing. 1 in 10 high school students have been purposely hit, slapped, or physically hurt by a boyfriend or girlfriend. This comes from In Living Your Dreams. This is a statistic that comes from them. 1 in 3 adolescents in the U.S. is a victim of physical, sexual, or emotional or verbal abuse from a dating partner. This again comes from loveisrespect.org. Dating, this comes from their statistics. Now, girls and young women between the ages of 16 and 24 experience the highest rates of intimate partner violence, almost triple the nation average. And again, we usually see more of a higher rate between girls than we do boys. And the reason why that is because girls are more opted to actually be more verbal than there are boys in the high school age. Now, we wish that boys would be more verbal and we wish that boys would come out a little bit more. Now that we see more of a transgender, we know that boys are now coming out. But we wish there was more of a statistics. Now we're looking into that. I actually made a claimation or a claim to Johns Hopkins University to actually want to do a test on that, but we'll see what happens. Now there are some warning signs, which 47% of tweens have been in a romantic relationship, then 19% of those have been abused. 34% of those report being verbally abused in their relationship. 62% were tweens. Now parents who know of controlling behaviors, 37% did not know of that. Nearly 80% have had that conversation with them, but still 3% don't even know that. Okay. Now, there's a lack of awareness, huge lack of awareness. Only 67% of adolescents who were abused in a relationship tell somebody. And this, again, goes back into lack of awareness because there is no real studies that have been done to really educate our educators. They don't educate a lot of teachers. They don't educate proper psychologists and counselors in the school systems. They don't educate anyone. 81% of parents believe that teen dating abuse is not an issue. They don't teach proper parents and the school systems to come on in and help out. There's no real sexual, although sex ed is a small part, used to be a huge part, now is not that big of a part anymore. They don't teach it very large anymore. It's just a very small snippet. So they don't teach about, hey, teen dating abuse. They only teach a very small part of sex ed. So that's a very big issue. 80% of teens in teen dating abuse is a very big issue. So it's 80%. It's not like saying 18. We're saying 80. Do you understand? 80 is a very large number. Only 9% of abused teens seek help, and rarely do they go to parents, and hardly ever do they go to teachers. And so having a conversation with your own teenagers or your own young adults is imperative. So you can go to your young adults or teenagers or your tweens and explain to them about teen dating violence. Know the red flags and warn them and watch out. If you feel like your partner may be abusive, watch out for these warning signs and explain to them. Put downs are not okay. Not letting you make your own decisions is not okay. Refusing you to go to work because there is young adults, or going to school is not okay. Physical abuse like shoving or slapping or choking or hitting is not okay. Threatening to commit suicide because we have seen teenagers make suicide pacts is not okay. Taking your money is not okay, you know, and sabotaging birth control because there has been teenagers that have said, hey, how about you don't take your birth control anymore and we can stay together forever. And then they leave the girl pregnant. And then the girl has a baby. That's not okay. And they do that. They gaslight. They control you when they see you, where you go, who you see, what you're doing. They threaten you. They even threaten your pets. They destroy your property or your parents' property. Or they even destroy college property or your dorm. And that's not okay. they pressure you and forcing you to have sex or do things you're not comfortable with. And so those are just a little bit of warning signs. So how can you stand up and stand, you know, speak out and stand out? These are just things that parents kind of conversing and talking to, and digital abuse and how to really be able to talk to your teens. And I hope that everyone can kind of see this is, you know, speaking out and standing up, you know, it's okay to turn off your phone, you know, certain teenagers and, being able to watch certain movies. There's a great movie called, you know, Reviving Ophelia, which, you know, the teenager couldn't even turn off her phone because she was being domestically abused. And just turn it off. It's okay to do that. Don't respond to hostile, harassing, abusive, or inappropriate texts or messages. If you got to change your number and ask your mom and dad to change it, it's okay to do that. Tell a trusted adult. Even if you feel like that trusted adult might not listen, it's okay. Just tell a trusted adult, you know, maybe an aunt, an uncle, somebody. You have the right to be alone and spend time with your friends. Be mindful when you're using check-ins on social channels, because nowadays, even your social channels can be traced. Facebook can trace you, and you can be traced on Facebook. Change your phone number. Don't send any messages when you don't want to be seen by others. You don't have to share your passwords. Save your documents, your troubled texts, and need to be evidence. What is digital abuse looks like? Constant texting and make you feel like you're being separated from your phone or your world. Status put downs and status updates. Make sure that if you have them, take a copy of them or screenshot them. Use networks like Facebook, Twitters, Foursquares. You know, now we have TikTok, Snapchats, whatever, and tab them. Send your unwanted explicit pictures or videos and on demand. If somebody sends you an explicit picture or something like that and you're underage, you need to report that to the police department immediately because it is illegal. Any underage pictures, you know, and this is a story that I usually tell a lot of teenagers, which they do not believe me until I get into the school. If you take a photo, okay, of an underage person while they are underage, let's say that you are a boy, and you take a picture of an underage girl and you send it to another underage boy, you can get in trouble and you can be placed under sex offenders list. And a lot of boys are flabbergasted when they're going, is that true? And I said, oh, it's very true. Not only is it true, but there is a video on YouTube of a 34, he's 30, I think he's almost 36 now, maybe 40, I don't know. When he was 12 years old, he took a picture of a young girl under her dress. He texted to his friend, and he got himself in trouble. The judge said he has to be placed on the sex offenders list because the girl had no idea that that actually happened. You know, she was it was sent to him. They were making mocking of her in the locker room, and she had no idea. Now, the young girl went to court. They, you know, unfortunately, this young boy is now on the sex offenders list for the rest of his life. He can no longer get a good job. He can no longer go to sign up in the military. He can no longer, you know, his college is damaged for him. Everything was damaged. And a lot of these kids think it's okay to just text whatever. You can't text whatever. I told both of my boys, don't ever do that. Okay? You can't just text whatever and think that. So that's something just to keep aware, guys. Keep aware. So messages for teens who are dating. Number one, first and foremost, seek relationships that are full of respect and kindness. Number two, relationships should make you feel good, not worse. Number three, don't let peer pressure overshadow your own intuition. Number four, no form of abuse can be part of a healthy relationship. Number five, abuse cannot happen to anyone. It could happen to anyone. Number six, remember that there is a thin line between the flattery of attention and a controlling behavior. Number seven, when it comes to dating, take it slow. Number eight, don't be afraid to ask for help or guidance when your situation happens and it's comfortable. Number nine, relationship may end. It always does if it happens like this. Number 10, your early relationships are good practice opportunities for later relationships. But I always tell kids, look at the bill, the dating bill of rights. I have the right to trust myself and my intuitions, be respected as a person, change my mind, express my feelings, refuse a date, and not be physically, emotionally, or sexually abused. But just overall, parents, please, overall, make sure that you know what an adultism is and how it applies to you. The power of adultism over children is to not be prejudiced and accompanying systematic discrimination against young people. That the bias towards adults and the social addiction to adults includes their ideas, activities, and attitudes. That what stories our stories or tell or hear about what it means to be a teen, tween, or young person. We need to hear that, okay? How do we dismiss or minimize the feelings, beliefs, or experiences of each young person and how we minimize, okay, how they are feeling, especially about young people in love or relationships are feeling right now in this day and age. Remember, this is a new age and things are different. We must let them reflect and give their perspective and not minimize their ideas, thoughts, or feelings because they're real. Just because they're young doesn't mean that they don't feel it. They feel, okay? So we have to remember that kids feel something. So don't minimize them. Just remember to let them reflect and let them have their own perspective. Just be there for them. And don't forget that this month is Wear Orange for February. And remember, watch the movie Reviving Ophelia. I hope you guys know what that is. Be a voice for others. Post on Instagram, Twitter, and Snapchat, TikTok, hashtag NTDV. My name is Cynthia Hale. This is all of my information. If you guys need to get a hold of me, it's 1-888-553-0339. You can go to www.domesticviolencerally.com or www.fft-helpingothers.com. Or I'm a coach, so if anybody ever needs me for any speaking engagements as a personal coach, I'm also the host of Guidance to a Good Heart on Mix Station, which you see here. You guys can also reach us on Mix Station and Mix Station Radio. And you can also purchase my book, Place of Healing. So I think that's it. And I'm going to stop sharing. So, Evangelist. I can't hear you.
Oh, sorry, I was muted. I said you did great.
Thank you.
You did great.
Thank you. We have one more guest.
Yes, we do. Next, we have Deputy Katrina coming. I don't remember her topic.
Yeah, she signed off. I'm trying to get her back in. She's not in the break room.
Can't hear you.
Sex trafficking?
Okay. We have Deputy Katrina coming to speak about sex trafficking. If
yeah,
you can
welcome she signed her out. Back. I'm trying to get her back in.
Oh, okay.
Oh.
Can y'all send me her email real quick?
Yes. Yes.
Let's put it on the chat.
Yep, I have it right. Sorry, everybody. 2 minutes. Enjoy the beautiful music.
Yeah, they can't hear us. Thank you. Back on you, Scent.
Well, everybody, we're having a little bit of technical difficulties. We seem to have lost Deputy Petrina. We might have to have her as a guest on our show. Guidance to a good heart. Unfortunately, we don't know what happened, and we've lost our special guest. I hope that we can get her back on a later date. We don't know exactly what had happened. It just cut off. We were going to have her talk about sex trafficking and, you know, talking about human sex and labor trafficking and talking about the pursuits of those issues as it pertains to our communities and how they can help out and how you can get help if you are facing those issues, and also talking about how the police department can help. But we've actually lost her, and you know, I'm trying to extend it so she can call back in, but unfortunately we've lost her. But if you are in need of any help, if you are facing, you know, sex trafficking, if you are facing labor trafficking or human trafficking, please do not forget to call the police department or call 911. We know that the Polaris Project is doing an amazing job. The Blue Campaign, they're doing an amazing job. And we know DHS is out there. We know that there has been some word right now that the Talon Project has been closed down. But there are 18 state attorneys that are actually working to talk to our president to try to get that program back in order and try to work on that. And if anybody is out there and would like to work with the domestic violence rally or work alongside with us to work to get the Talon Project back together again and help out, you know, victims, especially children who are being sex trafficked, human trafficked, and, you know, it's not just children, but men and women who are being labor trafficked and sex trafficked. Please get in contact with us. Evangelist is the COO of Domestic Violence Rally. I myself am the CEO, and we have, and the founder, and we have people that are in, you know, all in some states who are our directors. We are going to be having, and we're going to be doing a event on March 6th in which we are going to be talking to people who would like to become different directors. We welcome you so that you can be part of those discussions, to be able to talk to some of our representatives, some of our senators, some of our leaders in your own county and in your own states. And how can we address these issues, and, you know, talk about domestic violence, but mostly talk about why these issues are going on in your own state, especially if there is a lot of human trafficking, sex trafficking. But I thank you so much for everybody being here. Again, do not forget that Evangelist and myself, we have a show called Guidance to a Good Heart. Next week, beginning, well, this is going to be coming up, right? In March. We're in March right now. We're going to be having a show talking about it's Women's Month. We're talking about women. Yeah, Women's Month. And women's history. We're talking about women's history and women, powerful women of history. And we're going to be having some amazing women of history. So don't forget to be here. And we will give you that date. So don't forget. Don't miss that. Don't miss that. So thank you again for being here. And thanks for being at Understanding Your Worth. Thank you, Evangelist.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. I hope you had a good time. I hope you learned something that you can take for yourself or share with someone else, and just keep educating and bringing awareness to the world.
And thank you, McStation. Thank you for everything.
Thank you, I need to get a copy of that CD.
Thank you for everything, and have a wonderful day. Bye, everyone. Oh, Thank you, Tanise, for being here. I appreciate you. Is Tanise?
You're welcome.
Thank you. I hope you have a wonderful day today, and thank you for being here. And I truly, truly appreciate it. Evangelist just took off. I wanted to take a picture, but she was like, she bounced. You know what it is? Me and her are supposed to get together.
She got no.
So she was like, boom, I'm out. She's like, boom, I'm out of here. She took off. We were supposed to take a picture, but that's okay. I got her a number. That's okay. I got you. I got you. Hold on. Let me see if I can get her real quick. Hold on. Because I wanted to take a picture. Did you forget we're supposed to take a screenshot picture? Did you forget we're taking a screenshot picture?
A screenshot?
Yes, we're supposed to take a screenshot picture. All of us? Although Kayla left and Deputy's not here, so I guess it don't matter.
Miss Jarlene left too.
Oh yeah, Miss Jarlene left. It's no matter. Okay, I'll see you later.
Okay.
All right, bye. We can leave now. I'll meet you over there. We decided, Bahama Breeze.
Okay.
All right. Yes. Okay.
All right.
Bye. Okay. All right. Well, thank you so much, Denise. I'll see you later. Okay, so, okay.
Everything went good. You just had a lot of air in your line.
The what?
You got a lot of air in your line.
And mine?
Yep.
So everybody else was nice but me.
Right.
Why was mine all messed up?
I don't know. Yours had the most, yours had the air. Everybody else was clear. I tried to filter it out and everything. I mean, you couldn't hear it on your line, on your side.
At all?
Yeah, you got to mess around with your audio setting. Something going on.
And this is a new mic. So, and my mic is nice.
You want me to show you what you need?
What do I need? Okay, send me a picture of that. Send me a picture of that. Because you know I'm going to be leaving it, so I need all my stuff. I need everything. Everything.
I email you a US. It's a little USB channel board. And what this does, it boosts your sound and clears all that stupid stuff in the background. And you just hit it straight into your computer.
Okay, well, one, you and your girlfriend won't have to make your way because you know that I'm going to be getting a 3-bedroom, okay? So, after you settle yourself, do what you got to do. Wax on, wax off. Okay? Wax on, wax off. Do what you got to do up in Atlanta. Okay? But I'm going to be purchasing a small house down in Florida. So, I have 3 bedrooms. Evangelist is already making plans. Look at it. She making plans. She's just like, also, I can come stay with you for about a week or so. I see that. Is that Wilmer?
He not here. He went to a carnival this morning.
Oh, okay. So she was like, so what's on wife? I'm gonna come stay with you, okay? So about a week. She's like planning her day.
Right. You like the new setup?
Right? She's like, so this is what you got to do after you do your little wax on, wax off over in Atlanta. Okay? Get yourself together. I got 3 bedrooms. So you and your girlfriend come to my house.
Copy, coach. Copy.
Hey, coach.
Copy, coach. I copy. 10-4, coach.
come over to Florida, do what you gotta do, and get yourself together. You can get me all set up in Florida.
You know I will.
Okay, so I can do what you got. You got to get me all set up in Florida, and yeah, then you go do what you got to do.
You already know. The show was great too.
Was it good?
Yeah, it really went good. Except for losing her at the end, but besides that,
yeah, it would have been nice
really
to have
good
it
though. Online though. You was looking at it.
It was good.
You see all the pop ups and all the stuff I was doing. Yeah, the comments and all that.
It looks really good.
Yeah. So I'm probably the only person that probably ever did this with Zoom and both of them together like that.
It looks really nice. And there was a lot of people that were commenting.
Yeah.
And I put it on like every single one of my pages and groups.
You like that intro though?
It looks nice. Yeah. I like it.
I
do like it.
I know you were looking at it like.
It looks good. Yeah. And I like that little, I don't like the little jingle. So that jingle is mine. That belongs to God and to God. It don't belong to nobody else. That's mine. That belongs to us. Don't be giving it to nobody else. That belongs to us.
And see, the best thing with this stuff, I don't have to be up here to do all that. Like, all that was pre-set up before I even got here.
But see, you gotta give this. I've told you this like a billion times.
I know.
You have got to do a train team session. You got what?
I know. I'm about to get some kids here. That's the move. Get some kids and have them doing all this stuff.
But see, you gotta do another business plan and another business plan
and write
for
a
Mink Station, Maryland.
Yeah. Yep, and get a grant in here, then that way I don't have to be
yeah
as much.
You need to do one there, but see, and then you need to do Eastern Shore, too.
Yeah, they going to get it together.
You need to do, but I don't know about Eastern Shores. That's y'all thing, and you got to figure
out
what
you're doing.
And you
know what? It's nothing
Eastern
down there. It's the people that's down there that don't, they really got to.
Because I already know how I'm going to be doing Florida. I already know it. I got it in my mind already.
Yeah, it ain't hard. You know? I'm sorry.
Because I got the college that's right around the corner from my house. I got UCF that's right around the corner from my, literally down the street. That's my market.
Right.
I already know how to market it. And I got two other high schools.
They ain't hard.
Yeah.
I'm just, I really think once, I'm really trying to be prepared so when COVID ends, I'll be bam, right in it. You
but in
I mean?
Florida, everybody's already in high school.
I know. Florida's a whole different ball game. I was tripping when I was down there. They acting like COVID don't even exist.
They don't exist. It don't exist. It's not there. It's unavailable.
Somebody hit me up by the gig. This thing don't never stop.
That's why I said you need to talk to Eastern Shores and tell them if this is going to happen over there, they need to get themselves a business plan like I wrote with Tamika.
Yep.
And get
really
your contracts different. But then if that happens, then the contracts will have to be different. We'll have to fix the contract. Your contracts will have to change with the signatures of you and Wilbur. Then they'll have to sign the contracts with you because they have to be exclusive contracts. Exclusive contract.
So you like your template I had made up for you and all that?
Yeah.
Everything was on point except for losing the last lady. And then she was right there before y'all went right to the segment, and she was just gone, like that.
Yeah, and maybe we should have had her, like, in the middle or something.
Yeah.
And I should have been last.
Yeah, that's what it was. She probably got caught up sitting there waiting. That's the only thing about doing these type of things, you know?
Yeah, you have to have all your guests in the beginning and you last.
Yeah, you and Patricia should have went last. You know what I mean?
Yeah. Because these people don't want to wait. Nobody ever wants to wait. Nobody ever wants to wait.
Absolutely.
And the only reason why I had her last was because she told me she had an appointment. So right. I told her.
Right, but she came on first. Talking about, oh, I made it early because I ain't had no the appointment got canceled or something.
Well, yeah, that's why she told me on the email. I said, okay, no worries. I'm going to put you last. And that's why I put her in the schedule. If you listen, I do my schedules early.
Yeah.
I told Liza. I said, Liza, do this schedule. I want it this way. This is the way I want the schedule to look like.
It happened. Hey, but besides that, it was wonderful.
It looked good.
It was definitely easier than the rally. Well, the rally, boy, that had me going.
you better get ready because this rally this year, whew, Jesus.
No, I'm getting a team. That's what I'm going to do. I'm not going to be sitting here doing everything myself.
No, this rally this year is going to be crazy because I already have a couple senators. They saw Senator Pat Roberts. And so they were like, yeah, we saw Senator Pat Roberts. We think we want to do it this year. And that's only because they wanted to be voted again. Right. They wanted to be voted again. That's right. Why. They're not stupid.
The politic game have changed.
Yeah, that's why. They saw Pat Roberts. They want to be voted again. They know what's going on. People ain't stupid.
Yeah. The whole game have changed.
Yep. See, look, I'm gonna show you what it looks like. Hold on, I'm gonna change the. See, look. See what I bought? Look.
Okay. Yep. You just probably need this little channel board, cause whatever you plugged into, it might be giving some air in the background, and you don't know it. You know what I mean?
Yeah, but see, that's why I use the headphones.
Right. So what happened is you using that computer audio, and the headphones wasn't registered. So that's where the air coming from. Yep. Trust me, I know. That's why I get these. And it says, I wish I could ship this one to you, but I don't use it. You send me an address, I ship the right people.
Well, you know what? I'll try to come. You know what? We're thinking about just changing the date of the women's thing because we was going to do it at the beginning on Monday, but we don't have time and we don't have the people. She wanted to put four ladies or four or five ladies, but you know what? I don't have everybody. And the one person that we were supposed to have canceled. Another lady had a meeting. Chrissy Sykes is so busy right now because she has the Funny Face program that she's running. So I think probably by Thursday. I could come up to the station, but I don't know what you're doing. Are you doing something on Thursday?
When I get off, I'll be pretty much free. Don't have to come up. I'll mail it to you. It ain't that hard.
It doesn't matter.
This ain't heavy. You need it, I'll mail it to you. You help me out, why wouldn't I help you out?
What I do is to help Mix Station.
It's real simple. But you can hook up some speakers to this. You know what I mean? It's all types of stuff you can do with this little box.
So you have to help me because you have to tell me what I need to do.
As far as what?
As far as down in Florida, what do I need to do?
Probably get a team. Then that way you ain't stressing yourself as much. Of course you're going to do that. That's an automatic.
Well, yeah, you know how I am.
Yeah, that's awesome.
But I'm also an overachiever.
It ain't hard. hard. The main thing is, like, since I done found the formula, that's the easy part. Getting equipment, okay, that's the easy part. Now I got a formula that really works really good now. Without really, like, I'm not stressing and doing a lot of stuff anymore. You know what I'm saying?
Okay.
It's like, and I even got the template for StreamYard. So, like when you sent me your, when I said send me the flyer, I stretched it so it can fit the StreamYard screen. A lot of the stuff don't fit on StreamYard screen, so I have to stretch it to the side. So I can send you the template, and you just put the template up in Carver, and it'll give you the right size, and you stretch it to the size that it needs to be.
Now, do you want me to advertise Mix Station first, or do you want to wait on the business plan to advertise, and then, or do you want me to find people first before you come down and train?
When you first get down there?
Yeah, before you go, come down, because I'd rather you and your girl come down and then you train everybody.
So, yeah, I would
say, I'm gonna give,
I would say market it, get the team, market it, tell them what you're trying to do, get some financing in front, because you're going to do that automatically anyway.
Yeah, because what I'm going to do is I'm going to utilize,
because
I'm
video
still a nonprofit.
Training.
I still have my nonprofit. Right.
But I can do the training over video. And then
so
I
you're
going
to use Zoom to?
Yeah. It ain't hard. Okay. You know what I mean? The hardest thing is the setup for setting up everything to get the right sound. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And you can always, you don't have to get, like I gave on that option, you don't have to get the expensive board. The reason why I say get the expensive board, because like today, with your air and your side, I was able to filter it out a little bit.
Yeah.
And then boost you back up. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. But
it's a person like me that would know how to do that. That's more in the technical.
Yeah.
But, you know, a lot of little stuff, a lot of people just don't know. But I'm going to basically teach the basics. Whereas though you can be up and running, and really with two computers. It only got to be nothing expensive. I'm running now. I ran all your whole show today off of one computer. So with StreamYard, if you do the share screen to an application, it's on time. But if I do a share screen to like another Facebook page or another Google page, it won't be on time. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So once I learned that, I was like, all right, let me manipulate this. Then I made the template to hide all the Zoom stuff underneath. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But once I made that template, like, all right, this gonna cover up that. You won't even know you on Zoom. But StreamYard is good too, you know. It just Zoom for meetings is stronger. You know what I mean?
Cool.
Like StreamYard meeting, but when you invite people in and stuff, to me it's not as strong as Zoom. But I can use both. You know, you can do both. All day with Zoom, for your type of thing that you did today, it's perfect for it. StreamYard wouldn't have been good for that. You know what I mean?
No, because they don't do it. They don't.
Right. You can't
do
the. You can
share.
Put them backstage, right? And stuff. And then slide them in. But you doing the share screen and all that on your end, you can't do that
they
with StreamYard.
Mm.
So it's each one got it, you know.
But they said that they're going to. They're going to up their iOS issues. Did you hear that?
Cool, StreamYard?
Yeah.
Yeah, they got a lot of problems with Apple.
Yeah, they said that they're going to, because Zoom is, because Zoom can do so much.
Right.
They said they're going to up their game.
They have to. Now I just found out how to hide myself in StreamYard.
Yeah.
So we figured that out. But like I said, I don't like the meeting thing on StreamYard. I love the template. The template's the truth. Like when you got people in. But the thing is, the sound is better on Zoom. It's simpler.
Yeah.
Like with StreamYard, they gotta have earphones. You know what I mean?
And they have more reactions in Zoom than they do in.
Exactly. Like the timing is. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, they have more things in Zoom than they do in StreamYard. Not for nothing, but Zoom has a lot more capabilities. Like, they have the whiteboard.
Right.
All StreamYard doesn't have that.
Yeah, so I wasn't mad that I paid for both.
You know
what I'm saying? For my business, I'm not mad, but it's something that I had to do, and I'm glad I did it. But
yeah.
I'm glad that I'm able to use both of them in the StreamYard. The StreamYard,
yeah.
Streaming is the truth.
Yeah.
So now what I got to touch now is putting the OBS in the StreamYard. That's my next move. Which I know I can do because I know if I'm doing it with Zoom, it shouldn't be no problem with me doing it with OBS. You know, because it's all a shared screen.
That's true.
Right. So that's my next test. Because I got to do that NPR stuff before I lose that deal. I got to at least have that done by the, they gave me a deadline. I got to have that done by the end of March.
All right.
Yeah. So I've been like, I got to at least have two of them done by the end of March. So I'm already making a separate Facebook page just for that. So I don't get
blocked. Have you even started it?
Huh?
Have you even started it?
Yeah, I started the mix. All the videos is done. I just, basically, I got to test it and do it. So I'll be testing probably tomorrow. I'm going to test up here because I don't got nothing going on except for one meeting with these new clients.
Yeah.
So I'm going to test it tomorrow to make sure everything runs flawless.
Yeah.
And then once I test it, I'm like, all right, I'm good to go. If the test don't work, then I'm going to pre-record it. And then just green screen myself in the pre-record and act like I'm DJing. So my hand's going to be moving, but it ain't going to be real.
It ain't going to be for real.
All then you're going to see is my face.
I'm going to be like, I know that ain't real.
But look.
All right, I gotta go before Evangelist be over there and be like, I'm waiting for you.
Text me your address. I'll ship this to you.
Huh?
Text me your address or something. I'll ship this to you.
All right, I'll text it.
The only thing you gotta get is a USB card. I mean, a USB wire. That's it.
All right, cool.
You be good to go.
Cool. Cool. All right, we're
going to
go.
Or send me your address. I'll order you a brand new one and ship it to you.
Yeah, just let me know how much.
Man, look, I got this. All right? Let me treat you sometime. All right?
Cool.
Right. It ain't hurting me. Trust me, I'm doing good up here.
This is exciting, man. It's going to be really cool, man. All this stuff that's happening, it's going to be great.
Yeah.
Yep. It's going to be really great. Really, really great.
Yeah, I just hope this Tamika thing works out.
It'll be good, man. She has a lot of established clients. She knows a lot of people. She's got her kids. It's going to be really good. If she follows the business plan, you know, as it goes, you know. And I'll be here for a while, so, you know, not for a while. I'm leaving in March. But hey, what's going on? Hey, hold on 1 second, because I'm getting off of Big Nick off of the Zoom. Give me 1 second, okay? Okay, hold on. Yeah, if she follows the plan, I think she'll be good. She's got her, you know, all her kids are established stuff, and I think once she gets everything finished, all she has to really do is go into the school system, talk to some of our principals, really talk to, like, board members and stuff. And I know how to do that. You know, once she goes in with you guys, they see who you are, see who she is, follow the business plan. That's all she needs. She does need to have a financial plan. She needs a financial plan. I only did a business plan. She needs a financial plan.
Hey, sometimes you gotta get her to do her own.
Yeah, she needs a financial plan. I started the business. She needs a financial though.
Yep.
I mean, I can't do it all. As much as I want to. I mean, I don't have a financial plan for FFT helping others. Yeah. I mean, I have, you know, FFT helping others has a mental health plan, financial plan, business plan. We have a, group plan, curriculum. I mean, you have to have that. You have to have it all.
Yeah, you do.
Yeah.
Whenever I'm looking to get into this grant stuff, I'm really looking to find somebody to write me some grants.
Yeah. But, you know, once you get all of those things all lined up and get, you know, your... And she's got her vision, she's got her mission. She knows what that is. Now you can get your business plan going. You get your exactly what you want. You get your financial plan. Once you get all of that, you'll be good. You'll be golden.
Yep.
You know? And you take it. I mean, all you really need is a booklet to have all these things. Mm-hmm. And because people, when you ask people for money, they want to know where it's going. They want to know a financial plan. Where is my money going to be going and what are you going to be doing with it? A business plan tells them, hey, what is your business all about? That's kind of what we're already kind of wrote down, you know? And, you know, exactly, you know, what is each program about? That's the ones that I have with the mental health, the curriculum, you know, all those gives an idea of all of them in separate tandem. So, I mean, that's something you have to have, you know, per se. If you do mix station, you just give an idea with all. You know, if you're doing programming, then you do a programming status. So, you know, each of them will have its own tandem.
Yep.
You know? Now, if she wants to combine her efforts with you, that would be totally different. That would be a collaboration, a partnership. Mm-hmm. That's why I put it on there. You saw what it said in the business plan. She has to understand this is a collaboration, a partnership. Mm-hmm. And money that comes into MixStation belongs to MixStation.
Yep. Yeah, but she's gonna make some money down there.
No, she'll make her money too, but she has to understand that it belongs, that there has to be a separation of powers between two. So. Right.
But I can't make it down there to do crime. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm being honest. You know, give me something. With my time and my, you know.
Yeah.
I ain't greedy.
Right, but if it's got your logo, she's gonna understand that too, right?
I'm gonna start working on that tomorrow night.
Yeah.
I got bamboozled doing all this stuff.
Are you you're not redoing my station logo?
No, I'm putting the DMV behind it.
The behind it.
I decided to do it behind it with the stuff she was talking about with the DC flag in it, with the Virginia flag, but it's gonna be big. So it's going to be like, MixStation going to be right here, and DMV going to be big behind it. MixStation going to be cutting in the middle.
Okay.
It's going to be visible.
Okay.
Because at first I was like, I was going to put it underneath. I said, no, I'm going to make it different than, you know how I got the MixStation radio with the live on the end? So I'm going to just do that, the straight line, and put the DMV real big behind it.
Are you going to, like, arrow it in or something?
Nah, it's gonna be straight. Like, so if you put it on a shirt, it'll be like MixStation Radio right here, and the DMV is gonna be behind it. You'll see. I'm gonna do some different variations though.
How are you gonna do Atlanta's?
Huh?
How are you gonna do Atlanta?
I might do Atlanta totally different. Each I'm gonna have MixStation Radio in it.
Right! But how are you gonna? What are you gonna put in the background of Atlanta?
Atlanta, I might do the
peach.
Yep, I might do the peach.
Because Atlanta has a peach.
I could put it all in peach, make the peach, and then put the mix station like in the circle.
That'll look nice.
You know what I'm saying? Something different. You know what I mean? So each one is gonna be something different. Like each shore got the ships and all that in it. You know what I'm saying?
Atlanta will have the peach because that's there. That's a signature for Atlanta.
Florida could be an orange. Who knows?
Yeah. And the palm trees. You got to put the palm trees there because you know that we palm trees. You got to put the palm trees in the...
You know what I'm saying? On the side. I hook up, you know, it's nothing.
You just got to put the sun with the palm trees. That's signature.
I try to make each one where as though it could be put on a shirt.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So I try to look at it as a fashion logo than a...
Yeah, because there's merch. So you got to sell merch.
Yeah, and my merch, I got it lined up on the lower site. It actually sells a little bit. I might get like every 6 months, I might get like maybe $200 to $300 off of it.
Yeah, you got to sell merch. You got to sell merch.
I don't want to make the stuff myself.
Right.
So I
well, the thing with MixStation, this is the thing that I wanted to do, was we have Daytona 500. We have, because I'm so close where I'm going to be living, I'm actually right there by the Daytona racetrack. And so I have a friend of mine, because you know that I used to do the Daytona racetrack.
Oh, I know.
Yeah, like, I got friends. I got friends everywhere. Okay. You all know, I got friends everywhere. I got friends everywhere. When Joseph and Louis was little, I used to be the head of the Parents Association. And to make money, we used to have to go to the Daytona racetrack. And they used to give us a couple of the stands over in the Daytona racetrack. Well, I know the person who actually deals all the finances for all the Daytona racetracks. You know, the little stands. So she's a really good friend of mine over by the Daytona racetrack in the NASCAR. And so what I want to do is go and talk to her to try to see if she will let me post, you know, during the Daytona and the NASCAR, if she'll let me just have like a little merch table for MixStation there. I can't hear you.
Oh, I said it ain't hard. You know, I'm already down.
Because that will really sell a lot of our merch. And just to sell merch just alone. Because, I mean, we could have our speakers and just post music. That's fine. And just to have us there talking, that's great. You know what I'm saying? I don't know a lot about racing. Don't ask me because I don't know none about that. But we can have somebody who is a host that does know about cars. That I can find. Bet you that. Because I'm good about talking. So, I'm good about jibber-jabbing. So, I can find somebody that does know about NASCAR. And we could put our merchandise in the front of the table. And we can sell it. And my friend will let me. Because she's amazing. She's a Puerto Rican like me. She's a hustler. And she will try to get hers. That's what she is. And she will be like, Cynthia, don't worry. I got you. And she loves my brother. That's why she... Because she likes my brother. What she don't know is that my brother has her fiance. But that's good. I'm just going to let her know. Hey, my mom, don't worry. I'm going to find you somebody else. I got cousins. I got cousins. But, at least she's still my friend.
Right. It's always good to have a friend.
It's always good to have a Puerto Rican friend.
Amen.
All right, we all hustlers. We find our way.
All right, go ahead. We'll get up together. Send me your address so I can ship that thing to you.
I'll send it to you. All
right.
I'll send it to you.
No problem.
Yeah, but she's a real good friend. I'm going to try to see if I can get together with her. I'll get together with her. And my cousin works at Disney.
You know, people still commenting on this thing?
What, on the video?
Oh, yeah. I'm looking at it. They still commenting.
Shut the door.
But I still got it up, but it ain't live.
Shut the world.
Yeah, I love StreamYard right now.
In the name of Jesus.
You didn't even know I was going to do all that today.
What the world? There was 101 shares.
Crazy.
101.
Yeah, because I started sending it out to my team, and they must have started sharing it.
101. But you know what? The domestic violence rally, when we first started to like view it, was 1,500. Wow. 1,500 views. And our videos, just our videos alone, like our highest view, just the one with the two guys, was 700 wow. views. I think it was 700. Yeah, it was 700 views. Wow. Yep.
We got the formula.
Yeah. Our content is really high. I don't know why. Some of our content is real high. I think the lowest content we had was maybe 200 or 300. But our content is real high. I think if we stay around the same content we have, it'll stay kind of up there. It'll stay up there.
All right, let me get off this and I'll go to the front of
it. Yeah, I need to eat. I'm starving. Right. And you're holding me up. You're tell your girlfriend I said hi. Tell your girlfriend I said hi and I love her. Huh?
Send me your address. I tell her you love her.
Okay. All right. Bye.
Professional Administrative Services is a staffing agency which places executive, administrative assistants, and technical professionals. PAS also provides a virtual administrative service that is tailored to the business needs. Each service provides assistance for business owners by supplying permanent and temporary employees or administrative support on a daily, weekly, and monthly basis. Give us a call at 302-354-1997 or send us an email at deeavant@professionaladminserve.com. For more information, please visit Professional Administrative Services is a staffing.
What it feels like, and this is what it feels like.
Box you, but you pussy, you should put it on mute. Nigga, welcome to the Mecca, home of the home.
Why you think it's just a verse? I'm gone.
Good morning.
As the sun rise, the night dies. You was building pyramids and African empires. Yeah. Pale skin savages, straight hair like eyes. Still eating raw meat, a man that could light fire. He ever sold cocaine, he civilized pain. You were not the first black man in the medical range. Since you lied to oppress, you was just insane. Now look at you and understand.